We will discuss cervical vertebrae. So in the cervical vertebrae, we will see we have 7 cervical vertebrae. The first cervical vertebra is atlas, second is axis, then 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, they are having same features, hence they are called as typical cervical vertebrae, right? 7th cervical vertebra again will have some special features. So C1, C2 and C7, they come under like atypical cervical vertebrae, which will have some specialized features, whereas C3, C4, C5, C6, they have same features, hence they come under typical cervical vertebrae. Okay, so head bone we are just done with, right? So cervical vertebrae are identified by the presence of this foramen transverse area. So we have 7 cervical vertebrae, out of which 3rd to 6th are typical, 1st, 2nd, and 7th are atypical. So this area is actually called as body, which is small and broader from side to side. Its superior surface is concave transversely. These are the projecting lips on either side. Okay, and this big hole you are finding here is vertebral foramen. If you see the complete vertebral column, we have 7 cervical vertebrae, which are numbered as C1 to C7. We have 12 thoracic vertebrae, which are numbered T1 to T12. We have 5 lumbar vertebrae, which are numbered L1 to L5. And we have 5 sacral vertebrae, which have fused to form one single sacrum bone. Okay, at the tip of the sacrum, we have coccyx. So this is our vertebral column. Now if you just do one comparative study, like how the cervical vertebrae look. So first thing is, cervical vertebrae are comparatively smaller in size overall when you compare with the other thoracic and lumbar vertebrae. So as we have seen in the thorax, this area is called as body. Similarly, this is the body of the cervical vertebra, which is comparatively very small when you see the typical cervical vertebrae. Okay. So, and these projections are actually transverse processes. The specific feature of transverse process of cervical vertebra is, in the transverse process, we will have this hole, which is called as foramina transversarium, or like foramen, which is seen in the transverse process, which gives passage to vertebral artery. Okay. Such hole we do not find with the transverse processes of the remaining vertebra. So presence of the hole in the transverse process is the specific feature of cervical vertebra. We know this is the spinous process, and the spinous process in case of cervical vertebra is bifid. Bifid spine we will see. Okay, then. Now coming to this introduction part, so like generally the cervical vertebra are identified. How are they identified? By the presence of foramina transverse area. It is very well shown over here, foramina transverse area. Okay, so 7 cervical vertebrae we have, 3rd to 6th are typical, 1st, 2nd and 7th are atypical. Okay. Now, let us see the parts of typical cervical vertebra. So this particular area is called as body, behind which you have a big opening, that is vertebral foramen. This V-shaped area is this complete thing, whatever you see. Okay, so along with the lamina and this pedicel and the posterior aspect of the body, together complete thing, you call it as the vertebral arch. Vertebral arch. Okay, so this is right lamina, left lamina. Laminae are fusing to form spine. Usually the spine is bifid. Okay. So this is the superior articular facet, which usually articulates with the inferior articular facet of the vertebra above. Okay. And this is the foramen transversarium. Foramen transversarium has 2 tubercles. In front we have anterior tubercle and behind we have posterior tubercle. Okay, then, so the connecting area between these 2 tubercles, you call it as costo-transverse bar. Okay, so connecting the body with the articular facet, you have this connection as pedicel. Okay, then, Now coming to the typical cervical vertebra, let us describe body. Body is small and broader. It is concave on the superior surface with upward projecting lips. This is the upward projecting lip. Okay. Then anterior surface is beveled. Then coming to the inferior surface, this is the inferior surface which is saddle shaped. Then anterior border projects downwards and actually it hides the intervertebral discs which we usually find between the vertebrae. Okay. So we have one articular column. Then actually between, suppose this is one vertebra and then we have one more vertebra. In between the two vertebrae, there will be an opening, you call it as intervertebral foramen, which actually gives passage to the nerves. And of course, because these are cervical vertebrae, it gives passage to cervical nerves, which take part in the formation of cervical and brachial plexus. So this intervertebral foramen is actually formed by the superior half. Now see here, this is actually you are finding the intervertebral foramen is actually formed by, this is the inferior vertebral notch which you are seeing from the side superiorly. Like if you see one more vertebra is here, you will have superior vertebral notch of the vertebra below. So both of them will form intervertebral foramen. Suppose this is the superior vertebral notch and this is the inferior vertebral notch. If one more vertebra is here, you will have superior vertebral notch over here. So inferior vertebral notch of the vertebra above and superior vertebral notch of the vertebra below will join to form intervertebral foramina, which passes spinal nerves. Now see here, this is the vertebral foramen, so which is quite larger than the body. It is triangular in shape. It is so big because it has to allow the spinal cord to pass, and this is accommodating cervical enlargement of spinal cord. Hence, it is quite wide when you compare with the other part of the vertebral column. Okay, so we know like this particular area is vertebral arch, right? So this vertebral arch, there we will have pedicels which are directed backwards and laterally. Superior and inferior notches are of equal sizes. Let me show you. So this is superior vertebral notch, this is inferior vertebral notch. Okay, and these are the pedicels. Okay, so superior and inferior vertebral notches are of equal size. Laminae are relatively long and narrow, thinner above than below. So which are laminae? Let me show you. This is right lamina, this is left lamina. Laminae are actually fusing to form spinous process, which is basically bifid. Okay, so laminae are relatively long and narrow, thinner above than below, and superior and inferior articular processes form articular pillars, project laterally at the junction of pedicel and lamina. Okay, now see, this is the superior articular process and this is the inferior articular process. So superior articular process will articulate with the inferior articular process of the vertebra above. Inferior articular process will articulate with the superior articular process of the vertebra below. Hence, they form intervertebral joints. Okay, then. Now see here. So which is the transverse process here? This is the transverse process. So transverse process is having a big hole, big opening, which is foramen transverse area. So each transverse process has two roots. Okay, we have one anterior root and posterior root. okay, and they are ending as this sharp projections, which are called as anterior tubercle and posterior tubercle. So the anterior and posterior tubercle, they are joined by costo transverse bar. You can see this area is costo transverse bar. Okay, so anterior tubercle, costo transverse bar, together you call it as costal element. Costal element, that means sometimes if it is growing, you will see there will be a condition called as cervical rib. Basically ribs we will find in thoracic cage, but from seventh cervical vertebra this costal elements may grow and one rib may enter into the thorax via neck, which is actually compressing brachial plexus, which is usually causing certain compression symptoms. Especially ulnar nerve gets compressed in case of cervical rib. Okay, then so basically this costal element, which is formed by the tubercles and costo transverse bar, it is the site for the articulation with the ribs in case of thoracic cage. Anterior tubercle of the sixth cervical vertebra is large and it is given a special name called as carotid tubercle. This is the anterior tubercle, same thing. This is the posterior tubercle, this is the costo transverse bar. In sixth cervical vertebra, this will be little larger and it is called as carotid tubercle because it is related to carotid vessels. Now see here, this posterior projection, whatever we see, you call it as spine, which is short and bifid. Okay, so notch is filled with ligamentum mucae. You can see whatever area is there, see these are all spines, C1, C2, C3, C4, C5, C6. Okay, all spines are there and the spines are giving attachment to one structure which is called as ligamentum mucae. And also it gives origin to deep muscles of the back of the neck. Okay, then now the attachments, see here, this is the body of one vertebra, this is the body of another vertebra. Oh, sorry, this is the body of one vertebra, this is the body of another vertebra. Okay, this is the inferior vertebral notch, this is the superior vertebral notch. Together they have formed intervertebral foramen. This is the area through which the spinal nerve comes out. This is the spinous process, this is also the spinous process. Okay, this is the superior articular facet. Now body, suppose C3 C4 C5. Now between the body we are finding intervertebral disc. This round area is nucleus pulposus. You are finding there is one ligament which is attached to the anterior aspect of the bodies of all vertebras. You call it as anterior longitudinal ligament. Similarly, the posterior aspect of the body of the cervical vertebra, it's giving attachment to posterior longitudinal ligament. Okay, now between the transverse processes we have this ligamentum flavum, and between the spinous processes we have interspinous ligament or interspinal ligament, and at the tip of the spinous processes of the vertebra we have supraspinous ligament. Pause this slide and try to learn the attachments of the vertebrae. Okay, so this is anterior longitudinal, posterior longitudinal, then we have ligamentum flava, interspinous and supraspinous ligaments. Okay, now this is an articulated neck region where you are finding these are all, this is first cervical vertebra which is atlas, second cervical vertebra which is axis, then we have C3, C4, C5, C6 which will have almost same features, C7 will have again some different feature. Okay, C7 is actually will have a prominent spine which is called as vertebra prominence. Okay, in between blue lines they are actually intervertebral discs. Okay, so connecting them, see we have, this is the ligamentum nucae which is now written as nuchal ligament. Okay, so you are finding this is anterior longitudinal ligament. Okay, so ligamentum flava you are finding. Okay, then now this is the intervertebral disc which we find between the vertebra. The structure of intervertebral disc will show in the center nucleus pulposus, and the surrounding fibers are round, like they are arranged in concentric circles. You call it as annulus fibrosus. annulus fibrosus. This is the anterior aspect of the body where we have the attachment of anterior longitudinal ligament. Posterior aspect of the body, we have posterior longitudinal ligament. Okay, between the laminae, we are actually seeing the ligamentum flava, isn't it? Now, I told you the characteristic feature of the cervical vertebrae is presence of foramina transverse area which passes this artery, which is called as vertebral artery. So vertebral artery is one of the branches coming from the subclavian artery. So this vertebral artery enters inside the skull bone. Right and left vertebral arteries will join to form basilar artery. Okay, vertebral arteries will be accompanied by vertebral veins also. Okay, now if you observe, this is such a beautiful picture. We are finding, see, this is the atlas bone, this is the axis bone. Now between the intervertebral foramina, if you check, we are finding the spinal nerves. C1, C2, C3, C4, C5, C6, C7, we have C8. Eight pairs of cervical spinal nerves we will be seeing. C1 will be coming above the first cervical vertebra and it goes on. Okay. Then, now if you observe, now see here, these are the bodies of the cervical vertebrae, right? And these are the transverse processes of the cervical vertebrae. Now you can see few muscle attachments which are attached to the bodies of the cervical vertebrae. So what are these muscles we are finding? We are finding Scalene muscles. You need to remember the names of these muscles because when we do posterior triangle, basically they will be seen in the floor of posterior triangle. Okay, we will see Scalene. So like we have three in order actually, one behind the other, we have Scalenus anterior, Scalenus medius and Scalenus posterior. Okay, not only that, we have this muscle which is called as longus capitis. Okay, we also have a muscle which is called as longus pulli. Okay, so all these muscles are actually related to the anterior aspect of the cervical vertebrae. Now, this is the posterior aspect of the body, neck region. These are the spinous processes. I hope you are able to make out because scapula is also shown to emphasize the fact that this is the picture which has been taken from behind, back. Deep muscles, neck and upper back you are seeing. So these are all, like you are finding, these are the spinous processes. So from the posterior tubercles we see, the other muscles we will see here are the Scalenus medius, Scalenus posterior. Okay, then we will see the levator scapulae muscle. Okay, this is the levator scapulae which has been cut. Then we have splenius cervicis here. Okay, then we have longissimus capitis, longissimus cervicis muscles are also seen. Okay, then iliopostalis cervicis. Okay, this is the iliopostalis cervicis. So all these muscles are muscles of neck region which are attached to the cervical vertebrae. Okay, then now see here, these are the vertebral bodies, C1, C2, C3, C4, C5, C6, C7, right? So I said C1 nerve is coming above the first spinal nerve, first pair of spinal nerve. Okay, so that at the costotransverse bar, anterior primary ramae of corresponding cervical nerve. Costotransverse bar, I told you, it is present between anterior and posterior tubercles. At that point, you will see the spinal nerves are coming out. Okay, C8 is coming below the C7 cervical vertebra. Like that, we have 8 pairs of cervical nerves. Now, once we are done with the typical cervical vertebrae, which are numbered C3 to 4-6, now let us see the ossification. So, ossifies from 3 primary and 6 secondary centers. Okay, so ossification by 3 primary centers, one for body, which appears during 8th week, one for each vertebral arch, which actually appears during 7th or 8th week of the intrauterine life. Okay, so during embryological development, basically this is formed from the mesoderm or mesenchyme. Okay, in this you will see like cartilage is forming, you call it as chondrification center. We see primary ossification, which begins during the intrauterine life. Okay, secondary ossification centers appear after birth as we grow. Okay, now So the typical cervical vertebra, let us now try to name the structures. Number one is body. Okay, this between the two bodies we will have intervertebral disc, isn't it? Then this is the transverse process with hole. The hole is foramen transverse arium. It gives passage to vertebral vessels. This is anterior tubercle. This is posterior tubercle. Number two is costo transverse bar, isn't it? Costo transverse bar. Sixth is superior articular facet. Seventh is the posterior lamina, right and left laminae. Eighth one is pedicel. This is spine, which is bifid. Okay, it gives attachment to interspinous and supraspinous ligament. Tip is giving attachment to vertebra nuca, ligamentum nucae. Okay, this vertebral canal, number 10, it gives attachment like passage to the spinal cord. So before we move to this next vertebra, let me show you the typical cervical vertebra. Now see here, the typical cervical vertebra looks like this. Okay, so now first of all, you should be very much clear like which is superior and which is inferior. The superior aspect of the body is concave and it is beveled on the side. That means it has ridges which are raised on the sides. You can see this is raised ridges. I can draw and show you. Okay, so these ridges are raised on the sides and this is body which is concave. Okay, then so this is the anterior aspect of the body which gives attachment to anterior longitudinal ligament. Posterior aspect of the body gives attachment to posterior longitudinal ligament. Now when you see this area, you can see there is one hole, right? So this hole is nothing but foramen transverse arium. This foramen transverse arium is giving passage to which artery? Vertebral artery. Okay, now see here, see this one is like body. So when you look at the body, so on the transverse process you have two tubercles. One tubercle is sharp anteriorly, you call this as anterior tubercle. The other tubercle is also sharp behind, you call it as posterior tubercles. I'll touch them simultaneously. See here, one is anterior tubercle and the other is posterior tubercle. Between the two tubercles, the area is actually called as costo transverse bar. Costo transverse bar. Okay, then if you observe like this, I'll just shade it so that you will appreciate more better. See here, on this, the one which is shaded behind the body, you are finding this is superior articular facet. Okay, adjacent to the superior articular facet, this area is actually called as pedicel. This is also pedicel. Connecting the body and superior articular facets, we have pedicels. Okay, and this big hole in the center is vertebral foramen, which gives passage to the spinal cord. Okay, this is lamina. This is also lamina. The right and left laminae are fusing to form the spine. So this is one lamina, this is one more lamina, this is spinous process and you can check it is bifid. Okay, it is bifid spine, bifid. Okay, bifid spine. So see, the superior one will be very much concave whereas the inferior surface of the body is more or less flat. That's how you will identify. And the direction is also the body and the whole thing is projecting downwards. The spine should project downwards. Okay, so this is typical cervical vertebra. Now let us try to appreciate the same thing with the help of our PowerPoint also, so that you can make a comparative study. So this one is body. I'm simultaneously using this arrow also. This is body and my finger is body. Number five is the hole. I'm just passing the probe to show this. This is nothing but the vertebral foramen. Okay, so just anterior to the vertebral foramen, we will have the anterior tubercle. Behind, we have the posterior tubercle. This is the costo transverse bar we have, isn't it? So the one which I have shaded with chalk piece is the superior articular facet. The one which is quite big hole is the vertebral foramen. Okay, so these are the two laminae behind, right? Isn't it? Right and left laminae. They are fusing to form the spinous process, which is bifid. That's it. These are number 8, connecting the body and the superior articular facet. At this junction, we have pedicles. Okay? So if you have bones with you, try to appreciate. Even if you do not have bones, do not panic. Try to take the help of very good pictures which I am sharing with you. Okay? Don't take excuses not to study. You will be landing into problems. Okay? And then, once you are done with that, now let us move to first cervical vertebra. So first cervical vertebra is also called as atlas. Okay? So the first cervical vertebra features are, it has one anterior tubercle, then it has posterior tubercle. This is anterior arch, which is comparatively smaller when you compare with the posterior arch. So this is the superior articular facet. The superior articular facet will be articulating with the occipital condyles of the skull bone to form atlanto-occipital joint. Atlanto-occipital joint. Okay, so this is the superior facet, which I will show in our bone also. This is the transverse process. The transverse process is showing a big hole, that is foramen transverse area. Okay, anterior arch will show anterior tubercle. Posterior arch will show posterior tubercle. In the anterior arch, you will see on the posterior aspect of the anterior tubercle, there will be a facet for dens. Dens is the projection coming from second cervical vertebra, which comes and articulates here. I will articulate and show you, don't worry. Now, let us discuss first cervical vertebra, atlas. So this is anterior tubercle, this is anterior arch. So this is superior articular facet, this is posterior arch, this is posterior tubercle. These are the lateral masses. Okay, this is transverse process, which has a hole which is transverse foramen, which gives passage to vertebral artery. Superior articular facet articulates with the occipital condyles of the skull bone to form atlanto-occipital joint. Okay, then. Now coming to see, this is the posterior arch. Now whichever is small is anterior, please remember that. So this is the posterior arch, which is longer than anterior arch. Okay, it has median posterior tubercle. Okay, so the lateral masses will have the superior articular facet, which is grooved so that it is articulating with the occipital condyles of the skull bone to form atlanto-occipital joint. Okay, now coming to the inferior surface, this was superior surface of the atlas. Now we are seeing the inferior surface of the atlas. So inferior surface, we have inferior articular facet. Obviously, this inferior articular facet will be articulating with the superior articular facet of the second cervical vertebra, that is axis, to form atlanto-axial joint. Okay, so now this inferior surface, the inferior articular facet, it is more or less circular, more or less flat, directed downwards, medially and backwards. You can see the direction. So it articulates, so C1 articulates with C2, isn't it? So this inferior articular facet of C1 is articulating with superior articular facet of C2 to form atlanto-axial joint. The medial surface has roughened tubercle, this one. The medial surface has roughened tubercle. It gives attachment to this yellow line which is shown here, that is transverse ligament. Transverse ligament. So this is the transverse process of both the sides, which is projecting laterally to form large lateral mass, okay, which is quite long, which is acting as a lever, which permits rotatory movements of head. It is pierced by a hole where star I have shown. This is foramen transverse area, okay, which gives passage to vertebral artery. Now attachment of atlas, C1, atlas. So anterior tubercle, it gives attachment to the same ligament what we have studied with the typical cervical vertebrae. What is that? Anterior longitudinal ligament. On either side, you will see the attachment of the muscle called as longus pulley. Longus pulley is attached on the either side. You can see this is our vertebral artery, how it is passing. The upper border of the anterior arch, see this is our C1 vertebra. So the upper border of the anterior arch gives attachment to anterior atlanto-occipital membrane. It is written here. Atlanto, that means atlas. Occipital, that means occipital bone. Hence, it has been named as atlanto-occipital membrane. Connecting the occipital bone and the atlas bone, we have anteriorly, we have anterior atlanto-occipital membrane. Similarly, connecting the occipital bone and atlas bone from behind, we have posterior atlanto-occipital membrane. Okay, this is nuchal ligament, which we have seen when we were doing the other typical cervical vertebrae. Same thing. This is the nuchal ligament. Ligamentum nuchae. Posterior tubercle of the atlas also is giving attachment to this ligamentum nuchae in the median plane and gives origin to rectus capitis posterior minor muscle on each side. This muscle we will be also studying when we do suboccipital triangle as a separate lecture. Now, see, this is our atlas vertebra, okay, our C1 vertebra. So it has groove on the upper surface of the posterior arch so that it is allowing the vertebral artery to go up. Right and left vertebral arteries will join to form basilar artery to enter into foramen magnum. That is the purpose. It has come out and it is continuing its journey. Okay, so this posterior arch is occupied by the vertebral artery and by first cervical nerve. This is our first cervical nerve. Okay, then transverse process of the first cervical vertebra, it gives attachment to certain muscles like rectus capitis lateralis. It also gives attachment to superior oblique. Okay, then inferior oblique, levator scapulae, splenius cervicis and scalenus medius. All these muscles we will see in the back region, which are taking attachment on the transverse process of the first cervical vertebra, that is atlas. Okay, now coming to the ossification. So it has three ossification centers. One is for anterior arch, okay, which is ending at the first years, and complete fusion finishes by 7 years, and the two other like primary ossification centers will develop for each lateral mass, which appears during 7th week and finishes ossification by 3rd year. Okay, now let us try to identify the points of this atlas bone. Okay, so what are those? I told you this is anterior tubercle, this is anterior arch, this is the area for dens, which is the projection coming from the second cervical vertebra, right? Number 4 is superior articular facet. Okay, then number 2 is the posterior arch, right? This is all posterior arch. Number 3 is transverse process, this is transverse foramen, right? Number 7 is groove for vertebral artery. Okay, number 8 we have, it is not shown. Yes, not shown, but that is the tubercle for the transverse ligament. This area, which has not been numbered, but two arrows have been shown. That is nothing but the tubercle for the connection of transverse ligament, which I have shown as yellow line. If you just play back and see, you will see that transverse ligament. This is the facet for dens, which has not been numbered, but it is 9. Dens. Dens spelling is wrong here. E should not come. D-E-N-S. Dense. Okay, so this is posterior tubercle number 10, which gives attachment to ligamentum nuchae, anterior tubercle, which gives attachment to anterior longitudinal ligament. Okay, so let me show you the similar features in our bone now. So now see here, this is the first cervical vertebra, which is called as atlas. Okay, so how to identify? You are finding these are the superior articular facets, okay, which are like more or less kidney shape. Okay, this is the anterior arch. This you can see like this anterior arch, it has a sharp margin. The sharp margin is anterior tubercle. So this is the posterior arch, which is wider than anterior arch. It also has a sharp margin. You call it as posterior tubercle. So we have anterior tubercle, we have posterior tubercle. This is anterior arch, this is posterior arch. Inside complete thing, you call it as vertebral foramen, which is quite big, because because medulla oblongata continues here as spinal cord. From the foramen magnum of the skull bone, the you will see the medulla oblongata continues here. So these are the transverse processes, and as you can see here, the transverse processes are showing hole. So what is the name of this hole? Foramen transversarium. Foramina transversaria is plural, which gives passage to vertebral artery. Okay, so these are the projections from the lateral masses. You will see the direction of transverse ligament will be like this, connecting the two structures like this. Now see here, this is the anterior tubercle. Correspondingly, inside there is so beautiful facet. If you have bones with you, you can appreciate, or else also I'm trying to show you. So this facet is actually for dense. So dense is, see, this is the second cervical vertebra. It has projection which is called as dense, also called as odontoid process. Phylogenetically, it is generally considered as the separated body of first cervical vertebra. If you observe the first cervical vertebra, are you finding body? No. We are finding anterior arch, we are finding posterior arch, we are not finding body. So during like developmental process, it is usually told like this dense is nothing but separated part of the body of this first cervical vertebrae. It comes and articulates like this. Okay, that's the reason it has a facet. Okay, that is, this is the, I'm removing the dense now. So this is the facet for dense or the odontoid process. You can see how the dense comes and fixes over here to form atlanto. What is the joint between the atlas and axis called is atlantoaxial joint. Now I will show you. See here, this is our skull bone and these are the occipital condyles. I will just shade them so that you will see better. See, these are the occipital condyles. So these occipital condyles will be articulating like this. See, it will be articulated like this exactly in our body. You can see. So between the skull bone and the first cervical vertebra, there will be a joint like this. Okay, the name of the joint is atlanto-occipital joint, because it is between atlas and occipital bone. Hence you call it as atlanto-occipital joint. Okay, both the things are shaded now. Inferior, like you are finding, these are the occipital condyles and these are the superior articular facets of atlas bone. Okay, they just articulate like this, okay, to form the atlanto-occipital joint. If you just continue the journey like this, you are finding second cervical vertebrae is articulating with the first cervical vertebrae. The inferior facet of the first cervical vertebra, superior facet of the second cervical vertebra, they articulate like this and they form atlantoaxial joint. Atlantoaxial joint. So you are finding between the skull bone and atlas, between the atlas and axis. Like this, we have two joints, you can see here, one below the other. First one is atlanto-occipital, second one is atlanto-axial joint. Okay. Hope you have understood. Tried my best to show you. Pause the video, repeat the video again and again. Try to understand the things. It's not difficult if you put your efforts. Okay. So I'll also try to share the bone along with the slide so that it will be one more revision for you. See, I told you this is the anterior arch, right? Anterior arch. This is the anterior tubercle. Anterior tubercle. Then these are the superior articular facets. You can see shaded ones are the superior articular facets. Okay, these are the transverse processes number 3. Okay, adjacent to that you have transverse foramen, isn't it? For the passage of the vertebral artery. So this is the posterior arch. Posterior arch. Okay, this is all posterior arch. You have the spinous process. Okay, so these are actually, you are finding tubercles on the medial aspect of the lateral masses for the attachment of transverse ligament. This is the facet for dense. Okay, so this is the facet for dense here. Okay, you can see. This is the facet for tense, this one. Okay, so that is all about atlas. So once we are done with atlas, now we will go to the next atypical vertebra, that is second cervical vertebra, which is called as axis. So axis is identified by the presence of this projection. What is the name of this projection? Dens. What is the another name it has? Odontoid process. Odontoid process, which is strong tooth-like process projecting upwards from the body. Okay. Then, so see, this is the odontoid process. So you are finding this is the anterior aspect where you are finding the body. You are finding spinous process, which is bifid. That means this is the posterior aspect of axis. C2. Anterior aspect, posterior aspect, vertebral foramen, superior articular facets, inferior articular facets, right? These are the laminae. Laminae are fusing to form spinous process. Spinous process is bifid. This is the transverse process. Transverse process is showing transverse foramen. That's it. This big opening is vertebral foramen. Okay. So like that, you should be able to make out the things. Okay, now. So axis, see, this is the body and this projection is a dens. So superior surface of the body is fused with dens. Dens articulates anteriorly with the anterior arch of atlas, posteriorly with transverse ligament of atlas. So we have superior articular facets which will articulate with the inferior articular facets of the atlas bone to form atlanto-axial joint. Inferior articular facets will be articulating with C3 vertebra to form intervertebral joint between C2 and C3. So that is, we have superior articular facets, we have inferior articular facets. So these are the prominent like areas. We have margins which are quite sharp and which are projecting downwards. Okay, then. So axis, it has of course the vertebral arch. So this becomes the vertebral arch. Okay. So vertebral arch, we know, like, it has pedicel, superior articular facet, which is directed upwards and laterally. Inferior surface is a deep wide. It has inferior vertebral notch. I'll show you. Laminae, right and left laminae, I said, they are fusing, right? This is one lamina, this is one more lamina. So let me show you. See, this is one lamina, this is one more lamina. Here it is the superior vertebral notch. Lower down, if you see from side view, this is the inferior vertebral notch. This is the superior vertebral notch. Okay. So, lamina is thick and strong in case of axis. Transverse processes are showing transverse foramen. Spine is also large, thick, very strong, grooved inferiorly, and it is bifid. Now, let us see. This is the first vertebra, that is atlas. This is the second vertebra, that is axis. This is dens, which is also called as odontoid process, which is articulating with the area which is there on the posterior aspect of the anterior arch of atlas, isn't it? Posteriorly, the dens is having attachment to the transverse ligament. So transverse ligament is such beautifully shown here. This attachment, this type of joint is actually helping in rotation type of movement. This is the axis of rotation, okay? And see, the there is a joint between the inferior articular facet of the atlas and superior articular facet of the axis, and this point is called as the atlanto-axial joint. Atlanto-axial joint. So this is dens, also called as odontoid process. Here you will see median atlanto-axial ligament is attached. Okay, then anterior surface of the body of axis, it gives attachment to various muscles like we have seen previously, longus pollei, anterior longitudinal ligament. Posterior surface of the body gives attachment to posterior longitudinal ligament, cruciate ligament, membrana tectoria. Tip of the transverse process gives attachment to levator scapulae, scalenus medius. Spine is giving attachment to ligamentum nuchae and vertebral muscles. Okay, now see here, this is the labeled picture. Number one is actually showing the dens, also called as odontoid process. Okay, this is the superior articular facet to form atlanto-axial joint. Okay, this area is the vertebral foramen for the passage of spinal cord, also called as neural canal. This is spine, which is short and not so much bifid. Okay, in this area, you will see the attachment of interspinous ligament. Tip is giving attachment to ligamentum nuclei. These are the laminae. Between the laminae, we will see the attachment of ligamentum flava. Okay, and this number 6 is foramen transversarium, which gives passage to the vertebral artery and vein vertebral vessels. Okay, so we also have the attachment 7. This area is for the alar ligament. Okay, upper part, it gives attachment to the apical ligament. Okay, so at this point posteriorly, number 9, it gives attachment to the transverse groove for the transverse ligament. Okay, this blue area is actually for posterior longitudinal ligament. Okay, so that is 7. These are the areas for alar and apical ligaments. Okay, this is for alar ligament, this is for apical ligament, this is for transverse groove for transverse ligament. Rest all are labeled here. Pause the video and try to learn the things. This is 7, second cervical vertebra, which is also called as axis. Now let me stop my PowerPoint and let me share my video to show you the bone. Now see, this is the second cervical vertebra, which is called as axis. So this projection is odontoid process. Tip is giving attachment to apical ligament, on either side alar ligaments. So I will just shade so that you will see the superior articular facets. So this superior articular facets will be articulating with inferior articular facets of the atlas bone to form atlanto axial joint. Correspondingly, you can see how the odontoid process is going and fixing in the area behind the anterior arch of atlas. Behind where I kept my finger now, there you will have transverse ligament, right? Okay, then the other features we have, these are the transverse processes where you have a hole for the transverse foramina, isn't it? Then you will see we have two laminae, right lamina, left lamina, both are fusing in midline to form the spine. Okay, this is not so much bifid. Okay, so between the spines we have ligamentum flava, and at this spine we have interspinous ligament. Tip of the spine we have ligamentum nuclei. Anteriorly we have the attachment of anterior longitudinal ligament. Behind we have the attachment of posterior longitudinal ligament. This big hole is for the passage of the spinal cord. Okay, so inferiorly also you are finding the articular facets. So these inferior articular facets are for the articulation of the third cervical vertebra. Like this, you can see it articulates. This is C2, this is C3. So C2 and C3. Okay, the inferior facet of C2 and superior facet of C3, they articulate like this to form the intervertebral joint. Okay, between them, whatever joint is formed, you call this joint as intervertebral joint. Okay, intervertebral joint. So that's it. Yeah, so that is all about the axis. So once we are done with axis, now we are left out with the last vertebra, that is 7th cervical vertebra. The spinous process is quite large, it is not bifid. It is large, it is projecting posteriorly. You call it as vertebral prominence. Vertebra prominence, the 7th cervical vertebra, I'll show you. So 7th cervical vertebra is also called as vertebra prominence because it has long, thick, horizontal spinous process, which is not bifid, it ends in a tubercle. Okay, transverse process is large. Okay, you can see here. This is the 7th cervical vertebra. This is body where we will have the intervertebral discs. So this is the transverse process. So we have transverse foramen. Number 6 area is pedicel. Number 4 area is superior articular facet, which will articulate with the inferior articular facet of C6 vertebra to form intervertebral joint. Number 5 area is lamina, which is fusing to form a single spine, which is very big and it is not bifid, isn't it? That's what. So this area we will have intervertebral disc. And foramen transverse arium, please remember, it is giving passage only to vertebral vein. That means vertebral artery starts entering the transverse foramina from C6 to C1, from down to upward, C6 to C1. Okay, that journey. So this is pedicel, this is spine. Okay, this is vertebral canal. Okay, keep this picture in mind so that when I talk this, you should be able to understand. Okay, 7th cervical vertebra, which is long, thick, horizontal, spinous process. Okay. Let me show you. Exclusively, now you are finding the 7th cervical vertebra. See how big, sharp spine is there, which is not bifid also. It is quite big, hence it is called as vertebra prominence. This is body. Superiorly, always you should see like spine is projecting downwards. Don't hold the bone like this. That is wrong. You should hold the bone in such a way like the spine is projecting downwards for any vertebra. Okay, this is the superior facet, surface of the body, which is concave. Comparatively, inferior surface will be little flat. This area will be pedicel. We have transverse processes where we have the transverse foramen for the passage of the vertebral vein only, not vertebral artery. These are the two laminae. Two laminae are fusing to form the spine. This is the vertebral foramen for the passage of the spinal cord. Okay, so this is the way you should hold the bone, with spine pointing downwards, not upwards. Okay, spine should project down. Okay, when you hold the bone, it should project downwards. Okay, so now let us discuss with the help of slide. If possible, simultaneously video on. Let us see the 7th vertebra. Like this is the long spinous process you are finding, which is not bifid, where it is ending in a tubercle. So transverse processes also comparatively they are large. Posterior root is larger than the anterior root. Anterior tubercle is absent. Small foramen transverse arium only because it is passing vein. Sometimes it may be double and sometimes foramen transverse area may be absent. Okay, don't worry. Such variations usually exist. No attachment of vertebra prominence, this one. So spine is giving attachment to ligamentum lucae. Okay, trapezius, rhomboideus minor, serratus posterior, superior, splenius capitis, semispinalis, thoracis, spinalis, cervicis, multifidus. Okay, these are the muscles of back. Foramen transverse area, accessory vertebral vein, posterior tubercle, it gives attachment to suprapleural membrane, which we have studied in thorax. Lower border, it gives attachment to levator posterior. Okay, ossification similar to typical to cervical vertebra. Separate centers for each costal process appears during 6th month of intrauterine life and fuses with the body, and transverse process during 5th to 6th years of life. Okay, this picture we have already seen. Okay, now let's conclude. C3 to C6 body is present. For C1 body is not there. Separated odontoid process, I say. C2 body is present. C7 also body is present. Anterior arch is present. Not. It is not there for C3 to C6 because they have bodies. Whereas anterior arch is present in C1. Okay, not there in other vertebra. Posterior arch is present in all. Spinous process is bifid in case of typical cervical vertebra. We do not find spinous process because we have posterior tubercle in the posterior arch, right? C2 spinous process is bifid and C7 is very long, no? Like vertebra prominence, long single spinous process with sharp posterior tubercle. In superior articular facet, it is bean shaped. For C3 to C6, it is, for C1 also, it is kidney or bean shaped. For C2, superior articular facet is oval. For C7 also, it is bean shaped. Okay, I hope you understood. Now, one clinical aspect I would like to add: during hanging, what happens is the odontoid process is cut. Okay, it is fractured and it compresses the medulla oblongata, the respiratory and cardiac centers are inhibited, because of which person will die during hanging. Okay, so thank you all, take care.